Good afternoon. My name is Christy Jones. I am the Justice Manager. I just recently accepted the position at Anishinaabeg Nation. I've been in the position for the last 3 weeks and, you know, trying to study the UNDRIP Act. I'm from Garden River First Nation, and I'm here to present help the First Nations understand preparing for change. So the United Nations Declaration Rights of the Indigenous People was enacted on June 21st, 2021. This is in consultation with the Anishinaabeg Nations. The Act requires that we develop a 10-year action plan, and it must be developed by June 21st, 2023. So the ultimate goal of this plan is to make sure that federal laws are consistent with UNDRIP. The Anishinaabeg Legal Department will be working closely with the First Nations to make submissions to Canada regarding the development of the 10-year action plan. And we are hoping that this will bring greater equality to the First Nations and help fix the relationship with Canada. So what our plan is that we will be moving into, we'll be having 14 sessions on the UNDRIP Act. The virtual sessions have been designed to be delivered in a format related to our Anishinaabe traditional teachings, which is our clan systems. And we'll be presenting UNDRIP in a respective to the clan systems functions and responsibilities. We will be also offering other sessions upon request. However, right now we have a time limit. We need to have submission ready for the fall. And just keep in mind that this is not the actual consultation. We're just gathering feedback on the changes that need to be within the written plan. The actual consultation and changes to legislation will be over a 10-year period. So according to the UNDRIP Act, the Act is to affirm that UNDRIP is a universal instrument with application in Canadian laws. It also states that we need to take all measures necessary to ensure that the laws of Canada are consistent with the Declaration. So in order to achieve these objectives of the Declaration, it means that we must prepare and implement an action plan. And the action plan also needs to include measures or key performance indicators to address. Sorry, my speaking notes are over here. To address any of the. Where am I? To address any information that needs to be within that action plan. So each year, the ministry has to prepare a report. To ensure that the measures of the action plan are implemented, and the report will be tabled at Parliament and it will be made public. So prior to UNDRIP coming into effect in 2021, Bill 76 was brought forth where it stated that UNDRIP shall have force of law in Ontario. However, the bill was not enacted. And presently, UNDRIP will only be working within the federal legislations. So we're not looking at the Ontario legislations right now. We're only looking at the federal legislations. In regards to where UNDRIP stands in laws, the Act is not protected by the Constitution of Canada. So therefore, it's not protected by Section 35. UNDRIP is not the same as treaty rights, however, is something less. It's more like guiding principles. The articles that UNDRIP present are not legislated federally. And the UNDRIP legislation requires that UNDRIP, that we consider UNDRIP and ensure that laws are consistent with the federal legislations. So as you know, within Article 18, Indigenous people have the right to participate in decision-making matters, which affect their rights through representation chosen by themselves in accordance with their own procedures, as well as to maintain and develop their own Indigenous decision-making institutions. A positive legal reference for UNDRIP was that the First Nations Land Management and Framework Agreement amended in 2017 referenced the commitment to UNDRIP. For instance, within the First Nation Land Management Framework Agreement, it states, and whereas the Government of Canada is committed to implementing the UNDRIP, and changes were implemented to include the employees of the First Nations with land codes in force now have to have protections in legislation such as limiting personal liability. First Nations also have greater control over voting processes, and First Nations can have greater control over capital and revenue monies. So this is a positive step that we're seeing more UNDRIP reference to federal legislations and changes to some of our already existing agreements and amendments. We're just going to go through some of the UNDRIP articles. Fred will go through them more in detail through the Martin Clan Dotem presentation. However, some key areas that we want to look at is, you know, Article 4, Indigenous people in exercising the right to self-determination have the right to autonomy or self-government in matters relating to their internal and local affairs, as well as ways and means for financing their autonomous functions. Article 10 states that Indigenous people shall not be forcibly removed from their lands or territories. No relocation shall take place without the free, prior, and informed consent of Indigenous people concerned, and after agreement on just and fair compensation, and where possible, with the option of return. When we're discussing informed consent, we must make sure that it's completely voluntarily to make a decision about an issue. Informed consent also includes disclosure and being educated about any known risks, benefits, and alternative options. Informed consent carries both an ethical and legal obligation, and implicit in providing informed consent is an assessment of the decision maker's understanding, rendering an actual recommendation, and documentation of the process. Within Article 11, it states that Indigenous people have the right to practice and revitalize their cultural traditions and customs. This includes the right to maintain, protect, and develop the past, present, and future manifestations of their cultures, such as archaeological and historical sites, artifacts, designs, ceremonies, technologies, and visual and performing arts, including literature. Article 12 also states that Indigenous people have the right to manifest, practice, develop, and teach their spiritual and religious traditions, customs, and ceremonies, and the right to maintain, protect, and have access and privacy to their religious and cultural sites, the right to use and control of their ceremonial objects, and the right to the repatriation of their human remains. Article 19, we'll go through this one as well, states that the state shall consult and cooperate in good faith with the Indigenous people concerned through their own representative institutions in order to obtain their free, prior, and informed consent before adopting and implementing legislative or administrative measures that may affect them. Article 24 talks about the right to traditional medicines and to maintain health practices, including the conservation of vital metal, medicinal plants, animals, and minerals. Indigenous individuals also have the right to access without any discrimination to all social and health services. 26-1 includes that Indigenous people have the right to lands, territories, and resources which they have traditionally owned, occupied, or otherwise used or acquired. Indigenous people also have the right to own, use, develop, and control the lands, territories, and resources that they possess by reason of traditional ownership or other traditional occupation or use, as well as those which they have otherwise acquired. So I'm going to pass the mic to Fred to talk a little bit about UNDRIP on Three Horizons.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Fred Belfay. Can you hear me okay, Christy?
Yep.
Cool. My name is Fred Belfay. I'm one of the lawyers at the Anishinaabeg Nation. I'm from Nipissing First Nation, but I've been with the Anishinaabeg now for 23 years, and very pleased to be here. Very glad to see people in the session. And this is a moment, an opportunity for change. There's lots of tools in our toolbox to improve the lives of First Nations. And I think every one of you that's here today is here for that very reason, to improve the lives of First Nation people and Indigenous people. And I look to you as allies in that process. Now, UNDRIP is another tool in the toolbox to make change happen for the better. And what I did in this slide here, it's called Three Horizons, and you'll see why it's Three Horizons in a minute. So I have in this graph, it has the axis going up and down. That's from a low value to a high value up near the top. And then on the horizontal axis, we have the present, which is at the left-hand side, all the way into the future on the right-hand side. And our reality is represented by the green line. And when I think about UNDRIP and what things we're talking about right now, I think about the legislation. Our reality, the legislation is controlled by the federal government, and our influence is based on whatever, you know, opportunities we may have, whether it's protesting, court cases, all those things we do to force change for the better. The UNDRIP presents another opportunity, another tool to move forward the red line. And the red line is our hopes and dreams. At present, they are, on the far left, that's where they are. We have much hopes and dreams for improvements for the future, and that goes up with time. When you make these, if you could advance to the next slide, Christy, when you interact these with UNDRIP, the value of UNDRIP right now it's only been enforced for a year now, and they're looking to implement it over a period of 10 years, the federal government. So right now the value of it is potentially very high. And over time, my prediction is that although just like RCAP, the Royal Commission on Aboriginal People, just like the recommendations on IPRWASH, the IPRWASH inquiry, they, over time you lose, people forget about them. But with UNDRIP, it is my hope, and I think everyone will share it with me, that we can use our hopes and dreams, we can use UNDRIP to change the green line of reality from where it is now and move it a little bit up for the better. People have done this with the IPRWASH inquiry recommendations. People have done this with the RCAP recommendations, all kinds of things that influence change in law and policy and government action. So that's the intent of this, to show that we can use UNDRIP as a tool to influence change to our reality. And it takes time and energy, I was at a conference where this judge was speaking, and he said that when he was a young lawyer, he went to the Supreme Court of Canada, and he had an opportunity to present on a case, and he spent days and days in researching, and he found actually recommendations from one of the judges at the Supreme Court of Canada from 30 or 40 years prior. And it supported exactly what he was saying. And he quoted it and used that to influence change. So really it's up to each one of us to have these tools and use it to make change. The example that Christy gave with the First Nation Lands Management Act is a good example. So there's an UNDRIP recommendation with regards to lands and things that are covered by the First Nation Lands Management Act. It was used to influence change over the act. The only thing that was missing was our full understanding of the potential of UNDRIP. And if we equipped ourselves with the knowledge and understanding and become conversant and have a vocabulary in UNDRIP, we can actually make those changes that happen, we can make them better and more reflective of our uniqueness as Indigenous people. So that's those two slides. Miigwech, Christy.
Great, thank you. So just in conclusion, UNDRIP is not as simple as reading and memorizing what the article includes. We also must be a participant in the interpretation of its articles. We also need to understand the subtitles and assist with gaining an understanding of its interpretation. We will and must be diligent and alert to government action, policy, and law that may be inconsistent with UNDRIP.